underlying game theory was a dark vision of human beings who are driven only by self-interest, constantly distrustful of those around them. And there was a mathematician at the Rand Corporation who would take this dark vision much further. He set out to show that one could create stability through suspicion and self-interest, not just in the Cold War, but in the whole of human society. He was the mathematical genius, John Nash. Nash was portrayed in the Hollywood film, A Beautiful Mind, as a tortured hero. In reality, Nash was difficult and spiky. He was notorious at Rand for inventing a series of cruel games. The most famous he called Fuck You, Buddy, in which the only way to win was to ruthlessly betray your game partner. Nash took game theory and tried to apply it to all forms of human interaction. To do this, he made the fundamental assumption that all human behaviour was exactly like that involved in the hostile, competitive world of the nuclear standoff. That human beings constantly watched and monitored each other, and to get what they wanted, they would adjust their strategies to each other. In a series of equations for which he would win the Nobel Prize, Nash showed that a system driven by suspicion and selfishness did not have to lead to chaos. He proved that there could always be a point of equilibrium in which everyone's self-interest was perfectly balanced against each other.
The equilibrium, this equilibrium which is used, is that what I do is perfectly adjusted in relation to what you are doing. And what you're doing, or what any other person is doing, is perfectly adjusted to what I'm doing, or what all other people are doing. They are seeking separate optimization, just like poker players.
Is each player alone?
That's the idea, that they are alone, they're separate. Doing something that is very non-cooperative, but very selfish. And then what all of them do works together, and deriving from that, there is a payoff to all the players. That is the equilibrium. But it's understood not to be a cooperative ideal.
But the stability, the equilibrium, would only happen if everyone involved behaved selfishly. Because if they cooperated, the result became unpredictable and dangerous. A famous game was developed at Rand to show that in any interaction, selfishness always led to a safer outcome. It was called the Prisoner's Dilemma. There are many versions, but all of them involve two players having to decide whether to trust or to betray each other. Imagine you have stolen the world's most valuable diamond. You have agreed to sell it to a dangerous gangster. He offers to meet you to exchange the diamond for the money. But you think he may kill you. So instead, you tell him you will take it to a remote field and hide it. While at the same time, he must go to another field hundreds of miles away and hide the money. Then you will call him, and each will tell the other the hiding place. But just as you are about to make the call, you realize you could betray him. You keep the diamond, and then you go and get the money, while the gangster searches fruitlessly in an empty field. But at the very same moment, you realize that he is probably thinking the same thing, that he could betray you. You have no way of predicting how the other person will behave. That is the dilemma. But what Nash's equation showed was that the rational choice was always to betray the other person. Because that way, at the worst, you got to keep the diamond. And at the best, you got both the diamond and the money. But if you trusted the other person, you ran the risk of losing everything, because he might betray you. It was called the sucker payoff. What the Prisoner's Dilemma expressed was the strange logic of the Cold War. The optimum solution, offering to get rid of all your weapons, provided the Russians did the same, could never happen, because you couldn't trust them not to cheat. So instead, you went for stability, created by a balance of dangerous weapons on both sides. And what Nash had done was to turn that into a theory of how the whole of society worked. It had enormous implications for politics, because it proved that one could have a society based on individual freedom that wouldn't degenerate into chaos. But the price of that freedom would mean a world in which everyone would have to be suspicious and distrustful of their fellow human beings.
The Nash equilibrium is important because one of the great fears of politics is that self-interest would lead to utter chaos. And what the Nash equilibrium suggests is that rational pursuit of self-interest, even in the face of implacable hostile enemies, will lead to a kind of an order in which all players agree upon the strategies that they're playing and that those strategies make sense to them. But at the same time, it's also paranoid because it's the idea of a human being sitting alone in a room, being able to totally reconstruct their opponent. Their opponent is totally implacable, totally hostile, and bent on their destruction.
Mathematicians had helped win World War II. Now there was hope they could protect America's strategic edge. Princeton University boasted the most elite math department in the world. Each of its graduate students was hand-picked. That year, one stood out. A 20-year-old from West Virginia named John Forbes Nash.
These young mathematicians were all pretty cocky, but he towered over them in arrogance and confidence and also in eccentricity.
John Nash was always an entity unto himself. When John walked into the room, you knew that John walked into the room. I think he thought of himself as superior, intellectually, mathematically superior. We thought highly of ourselves and each other, but with John, it was double. John was very clearly above it.
Nash rarely attended class, claiming it would blunt his originality. He was obsessed with making a name for himself and was always on the hunt for problems that had defeated other mathematicians.
There is something of that in my approach to mathematics. I have tended to think that the thing to do is to get away from what other people are doing and not to follow directly in anyone's recent work.
He didn't study anything. He didn't assimilate other people's work. What he did was to try to find his own way of solving very difficult problems. And he thought he had the talent to fulfill these ambitions of being the world's greatest mathematician.
Nash soon acquired a reputation for being both brilliant and odd. In the quadrangle, he rode a bicycle in figure eights over and over, and paced the hallways obsessively whistling Bach's Little Fugue.
Fine Hall is where the mathematicians met. I went there and I looked around. I knew a number of the people, but I didn't know them all. And I thought, this is the strangest group of people in the world.
Since arriving at MIT, Nash had solved a series of imposing problems in mathematics, ranging from algebraic geometry to partial differential equations. Unlike his work in game theory, these groundbreaking proofs dazzled the mathematical world.
We would all be climbing the mountain being mathematical perfection. He had a different approach. We came up this way, and he came this way.
In July 1958, Fortune magazine featured him as one of the brightest stars in mathematics. He had just turned 30.
for a mathematician turning 30, it's a lot like for a ballet dancer or an athlete. Age is your enemy.
By his own standards, Nash had fallen short. For a decade, he had pursued the Fields Medal, mathematics' highest honor. That year, he failed to win it again.
He was an intensely ambitious person. He was extremely competitive, and he was very bitter that he didn't get it.
At the time, I had some recognition. I was making some progress professionally, but I wasn't really at the top. I didn't have top-level recognition.
He threw himself into solving the Riemann hypothesis, the holy grail of mathematics. The work was mentally and physically exhausting, and ultimately proved futile. He began to worry that his best years were behind him. At the same time, he learned that Alicia was pregnant.
A psychotic break is usually precipitated by some stressful experiences. Often these stressful experiences involve a demand that the person who becomes psychotic take on greater responsibility.
Below his brash and confident surface, John Nash now hid another side of himself, one filled with anxiety, self-doubt, even fear. It would mark the beginning of a strange and tragic metamorphosis. On New Year's Eve, 1958, the Nashes attended a costume party at the home of a colleague. John went dressed as a baby. He wore a diaper and spent much of the night curled up in Alicia's lap. Even to those used to his eccentricities, it was a disturbing scene. A few weeks later, Nash rushed into the common room at MIT and claimed that powers from outer space were sending him coded messages in the New York Times. Another incident soon followed. He interrupted a lecture to announce that he was on the cover of Life magazine, disguised as Pope John the 23rd. He knew this, he said, because 23 was his favorite prime number. Then he began noticing a curious pattern on the MIT campus. Men wearing red ties. He was sure they were members of a secret communist organization. When the University of Chicago offered him a prestigious position, Nash turned it down. He was already scheduled, he said, to become Emperor of Antarctica.
John talked about the people from outer space who are destroying his career and the international organizations that were attacking him. Somebody you've known for a long time, to hear this kind of news is very unsettling.
Really, his personality seemed to change in a period of a week or so. It was very fast.
I mean, you're seeing a mind disintegrate in front of you. I felt shocked.
The math department chairman thought Nash was having a nervous breakdown and relieved him of his teaching duties in February. Still, Nash continued to unravel. One night, he painted black spots all over the bedroom wall.
Alicia tried to handle it herself, but at a certain point, it overwhelmed her. And when she turned to a psychiatrist, she was ultimately advised that he should be hospitalized. Here is this genius, and you were going to clap him into a hospital where God knows what might happen? I think it was very tough.
I didn't feel that I belonged locked up. I never went voluntarily.
Nash was taken to McLean Hospital, a private psychiatric facility outside Boston, known for treating the wealthy and famous. He was diagnosed with paranoid schizophrenia and given an injection of Thorazine to calm him down.
A delusional state of mind is like living a dream. Well, I knew where I was. I was there on observation. But I was able to think that I was like a victim of a conspiracy.
The delusions have often a cosmic quality, a feeling of ominousness. Everything that happens around you takes on a tremendous significance.
In madness, I saw myself as some sort of a messenger having a special function. Like the Muslim concept with Muhammad, the messenger of Allah.
Someone who visited him in the hospital asked him, how could you, a mathematician, someone who's committed to rationality, how could you believe that aliens from outer space were communicating with you? Nash's response was, these ideas came to me the same way my mathematical ideas did, so I believe them.
Said Newman, they are not going to let me out until I'm normal, but that'll never be. I never was.
I began to realize I would not be getting out of the hospital unless I conformed and behaved normally. So I would do that is if I would be sweeping the delusions under a rug, and they were able to come out later on. It could be triggered, and I would move very quickly to accepting it again. I don't remember all the details. The sort of thing that, like if you go under anesthesia, you remember only the process up to the anesthesia.
A nurse would wake patients early in the morning and give them an injection of insulin. Their blood sugar would drop, and soon they would be comatose. Some patients would suffer spontaneous seizures.
Insulin coma deliberately puts the body into total shock. This was done under supervised circumstances because if you do that too aggressively, you can die.
I remember some of the surrounding events. There would be a group of people that would be getting it, and then afterwards they would go out on the grounds and pass some time and drink sugar water. I got to thinking of the cruelty to animals. I became a vegetarian at the time that I was in the Trenton Hospital. I was sort of thought that one could protest against this sort of treatment.
In 1961, Nash was 33 and unemployed. Former Princeton colleagues secured him a research position, and he managed to publish a paper on fluid dynamics, his first piece of work in 4 years. He seemed to be better, but inside Nash felt a sense of loss. Rational thought, he wrote, imposes a limit on a person's relation to the cosmos. He later called his remission periods interludes of enforced rationality.
To some extent, sanity is a form of conformity. People are always selling the idea that people who have mental illness are suffering. But it's really not so simple. I think mental illness or madness can be an escape also.
Beginning sometime in the 1980s, after 3 decades of struggling with mental illness, John Nash experienced his second transformation.
I don't really remember the chronology very well, exactly when I moved from one type of thinking to another. I began arguing with the concept of the voices, and ultimately I began rejecting them and deciding not to listen.
His descent into madness had been sudden. His reawakening was gradual, almost imperceptible.
A portion of schizophrenics, after a long period of time, often do seem to get better. And how that occurs remains a mystery.
Slowly, he became more engaged and lucid. Word of his remarkable recovery spread. Those around him assumed new antipsychotic drugs were helping. But Nash had stopped taking medication in 1970.
I said, "John, how in the devil have you recovered?" He said, "I willed it. I decided I was going to think rationally."
He has said that he more or less put his hallucinations aside, like a conscious decision. I mentioned that to somebody, and she said, "Well, why didn't he do it sooner?"
The fact that people did not abandon him, that there were people who treated him like a human being, made it possible for him to reemerge.
This wonderful thing that happened to John could only happen in this little mathematical community that is very, very tolerant of certain aberrations and also at the same time incredibly admiring of gift or genius. That was what was important about Nash in that world, not that he was ill.
Two American professors and a German researcher have been awarded the Nobel Prize in Economics.
The three winners of today's Nobel Prize played major roles in bringing the principles of game theory to economics. Princeton's John Nash was cited for developing what has become known as the Nash Equilibrium, pioneering theory about the point at which conflicts get resolved. Under the theory, companies...
My wife said, "John Nash? You don't think that's the John Nash that we know?" I didn't know John was still alive.
I remember clearly, I heard it on the radio, and I said, "That's John." And I cried. All I could think was, I wish my parents could know this.
On December 10th, 1994, at the age of 66, John Nash received the Nobel Prize in Stockholm.
Dr. John Nash, your analysis of equilibrium and non-cooperative games and all your other contributions to game theory have had a profound effect on the way economic theory has developed in the last 2 decades.
At Princeton, Nash has returned once again to his work in mathematics.
I think it teaches us that we have to appreciate the particular talents of people who may be very eccentric and look at things in very peculiar ways. Those are often the people who will really have the most stunning insights.
Here was someone who had been lost. I think that's the inspiration, that people can triumph over this disease. I think it's incredibly inspiring.
I'm not thinking anything crazy, but there are different possibilities. I don't know what the future holds exactly, even if it's not such a long future for me. Of course, the future in general is presumably long, unless things really go bad, or unless some miracle happens.